I would like to introduce Dr. Chittenden, who is the Vice President for Statistical Science at WuXi NextCODE Genomics. Dr. Chittenden leads WuXi's NextCODE Predictive Analytics Initiative, which includes a number of deep learning and probabilistic programming projects aimed at furthering scientific understanding of human disease initiation and progression. Dr. Chittenden holds academic appointments at Boston Children's Hospital, Harvard Medical School, and Massachusetts Institute of Technology. He lectures there on biostatistics and mathematical biology. Dr. Chittenden holds a PhD in molecular cell biology and biotechnology from Virginia Tech. He also holds a Doctor of Philosophy degree from the Department of Statistics at the University of Oxford. His multidisciplinary postdoctoral training includes experimental investigations in molecular and cellular cardiology from the Dartmouth Medical School, and integrative functional genomics from the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and the Department of Biostatistics at Harvard School of Public Health. A major focus of Dr. Chittenden's work is development and application of integrated systems biology models to investigate evolutionary factors of human disease. His overall objective is to understand how genetic variation and somatic mutation regulate gene activity and subsequent disease biology. It is of immense importance to human health, and it's a pleasure to have you with us today.
Thank you, Renata. Oops. There we go. So I jumped ahead a little bit. Well, I'd like to thank everybody for your time this morning. I'd also like to thank Renata for this wonderful opportunity to share with everyone a little bit about what I do for a living and what I feel so passionate about and what gets me up in the morning. Now, I owe everyone an apology before I start here. I've changed the title here three or four times, so it's a little bit different than what you have on your program. And when I got up this morning and I looked at this, I still don't think that this title encapsulates the real essence of what we are working on. So I normally like to start with a slide that paints a picture for everyone and gives the audience an idea of where I'm going. And I have been using this image for a number of years now, but the guys at the lab said, Tom, you really need to rethink this. All this is really doing is illustrating the denial you're in about all the hair you've lost over the last year or so. So it really wasn't what I was going for here this morning. The message that I wanted to convey with this image is that I believe what we are looking at will fundamentally change our understanding or redefine our understanding of biology and afford for the first time the means to adequately or fully address human disease. Now, I'm wearing the statistician's hat now, and this is kind of a dry, boring topic, so I promised Renata that I would not put up a bunch of mathematical or statistical formula, but I am going to be talking a lot about statistics, and I'd like to open with this quote by the late, great Yogi Berra, is that it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future. Now, the first time I had given this data or this talk at a data analytics conference in Boston, I had a gentleman come up to me immediately afterwards, and I thought, oh, finally, somebody's actually interested in this stuff. He had a very stern look on his face. And I'm not making this up. He said, Tom, what were you thinking, citing or quoting a famous New York Yankee in the heart of Red Sox Nation? So for all the Red Sox fans, I'd just like to put your mind at ease. This quote was really taken or can be attributed to Niels Bohr, the Danish physicist. And what he was getting at in a seminar, he was talking about quantum physics. And basically what the meat of what he was trying to convey was that we don't know enough about how the universe works to adequately model it. And this has direct bearing on what I want to share with you today. These deep learning tools that I am so passionate about are redefining our understanding of biology, and as they do so, they are becoming more and more robust, and we have a means to actually leverage this information. Now, I'm a scientist, and the last thing that I want to do is come across as a quintessential salesman or the midnight infomercialman, and I'm sure you've all heard that. But wait, don't go yet if you think it couldn't get better if you order by midnight. That's not my intention this morning. But by the time we get to the deep learning aspect of this talk, I imagine that I'm going to get very adamant about what I'm sharing with you this morning, because these are very recent results, and they are just fantastic and incredible. Now, if they were by design, I probably wouldn't be so excited about it, but there has been a twist and a turn and a real surprise around every corner. So before I get started, I'd also like to quote George Box. He has been referred to as the greatest statistical mind of last century. And in the 70s, he made this statement in a position paper that he stated, essentially all models are wrong, but some are useful. And as of about a month ago, I wholeheartedly agreed with this. But I think what you'll see when I get to our results on the deep learning is that I don't believe this anymore. I think we are developing models that are learning to read and write the human genome in amazing ways. Okay, so what I'd like to share with you here, very briefly, or in a short period of time, I'm going to introduce the Computational and Statistics and Bioinformatics group here at WuXi NextCODE Genomics. I've spent 8 months assembling a group of just basically real rock stars in the field. I'm going to talk about gene set analysis or enrichment and how it can be used as a powerful feature selection tool. I'm going to tie that into some of the early work I did at the University of Oxford with Chris Holmes about machine learning and predictive modeling. And then finally, the last part of the talk, I'm going to show you our recent results in deep learning in the biosciences. Okay, so this is the team. We've got eight gentlemen on board right now. The CEO of our company is convinced that what we are doing with deep learning is just absolutely fantastic. So he is positioning the company around these data analytics or these predictive analytics. And so our team is growing very rapidly. And I'd love to tell you or introduce all of these gentlemen and what they do with the group, but since we've got a limited amount of time, the individuals that generated the results that I'm sharing with you today can be directly contributed to Ryan Abo, Pengwei Yang, Zhuhua Chen, and Haigu Wu. Okay, so gene set analysis and feature selection. This is something that I started working on about 10 years ago, and again with Chris Holmes at the University of Oxford. So just to set the stage, and I don't want to insult anyone's intelligence, but this builds on itself. I'm just going to take you through what gene ontology is, because it's one of the biomedical ontologies that we're actually querying or extracting information from. So back in 2002, the Gene Ontology Consortium published three controlled vocabularies to describe biological knowledge for genes and gene products. The first one is biological process, or how a gene or gene product pertains to an organism. Cellular component, its location within the cell. And then finally, molecular function, the task performed at the molecular level. Now, this is how the data is structured in many biomedical ontologies. And I'd like to focus your attention here on figure C. This is actually the gene ontology. It's structured as a directed acyclic graph. And as you can see here, the parent term or the root node is biological process. If I can do this, there you go, biological process. And as you delve deeper down into the DAG, these child terms become more specific. So we have biological process, cell division, cytokinesis, and cytokinesis after mitosis. Now, what's very interesting is that we are building analytics or predictive analytics to also query other ontologies. So I've also given an example here of the human phenotype ontology and the SNOMED CT clinical ontology that physicians are heavily reliant upon. And this has been around since probably the 1940s. So I have spent my career building statistics or statistical methods on how to query these individual child terms or nodes and extract meaningful information. So we are mapping attributes such as mutations or expression profiles down onto genes and then seeing the statistical likelihood of a group of genes that are abnormal have clustered on a specific node. So just to highlight the utility of this, while I was at the research computing group at the Harvard Medical School, Chris Walsh's group, he's a very well-known professor in neuroscience from Boston Children's Hospital, two of his postdocs came over and said, we've generated some very interesting data. And it had to do with single neurons, so it was a single cell sequencing project, and they had isolated single neurons from three different patients. And they weren't quite sure what to do with that. So these two postdocs came over to the office. I asked them if they had run functional enrichment or tried to query pathways from this data. Now, they both immediately dismissed me, and the reason for that is that mutagenesis was believed to be a random process. And if it was truly random, you would not find a pattern of functional enrichment with these gene ontology terms. So the postdoc, I saw the light come in Mike Lodato, which was the lead postdoc on this paper, went back to the lab and called me about 2 hours later, very excited. And he said, Tom, there is something here. We do have functional enrichment. Can you help us build a tool to actually control for the next generation sequencing approach that they had taken? So it took about a year to build this tool, and the paper eventually landed on the cover of Science. Now, this is not the only reason why this landed on the cover of Science, but as you can see, of the top 8 gene ontology terms, 5 of them had to do with neuronal development. So we have neuron development, nervous systems development, and axon guidance. I had published a tool back in 2012 that actually looks at delineating or taking a nested classification approach to find out what's driving these underlying pathways, but we didn't have it built on next generation sequencing data. So I asked if they wanted to take the time to do that, and said, no, we don't want to have anyone beat us to the punch, so we went ahead and published that. And what I normally do is get into the weeds about how this actually works, and I'm not going to end up putting everybody to tears here this morning. But what we've done is we have built this tool to control for some of the things that are associated with next generation sequencing data. And this is the output. And we are feverishly working with Chris Walsh's group again for a second follow-up paper. And what I'd like to highlight is that here are the upper level terms that we found in the original Science paper. So you have nervous system develop, neuron projection development, and now we've found these terms, or these molecular pathways, if you will, that are actually driving the significance of these upper level terms. And here you have negative regulation of histone acetylation, which supports the theory that mutagenesis is not a random process. In that original paper, we showed that it has to do with transcriptional activity, or the activity level of these genes, how they are turned on and turned off. And this term right here actually supports that. And so what we've done, and I started working on this about 10 years ago, is that we are looking at the genes that are associated with these very specific terms to build predictive analytics. So this is the part in the talk that I need to give you a little bit of a historical background with this, machine learning and predictive modeling. And this is the work that I first started with Chris Holmes at Oxford. And so I've thrown this up here to give you a little bit of an indication or a little bit of background of what we were doing with modeling breast cancer molecular subtypes. Now, we were looking at the time estrogen receptor positive versus estrogen receptor negative. So these two main classes here. And when I get to the deep learning, I'll show you how we've actually looked at or classified something very specific, which is luminal A and luminal B. So this was our first attempt, pretty close to 10 years ago, and this is an ROC curve, or what we refer to as a receiver-operator characteristic curve that evaluates our predictive classification, or how well we actually did. So we have our true positives here on the y-axis, and on the x-axis are our false positives. We had a very large breast cancer data set of about 1,000 patients or so. We were training our algorithm on 121 patients, and then we were testing our algorithms on close to 1,000 here. The curves that we have, so if you take a diagonal line from the origin here up to the upper right-hand corner aspect of this figure, is that you have your line of best guess. It's about a 50-50 chance that you're getting it right. So our nested approach here is this red curve, and we were at about 90% classification accuracy. So 9 out of 10 times, we were calling the right call between estrogen receptor positive and estrogen receptor negative. And that was pretty good about 10 years ago. But then we looked at something that was much more difficult. We looked at 5-year relapse-free patient survival. And again, on your diagonal here, which is a line of best guess, we weren't doing very well. So we were only at about 66% of the time. So 66 out of 100 times, we were making the right call. But we found something very interesting because we compared this model to Robert Tibbershirani's group. Professor Tibbershirani is a very well-known, famous biostatistician at Stanford University. So we compared it to his SPCA model, so his supervised principal component analysis, and we found something very interesting. So these are the terms, or the actual molecular pathways, that the SPCA model said were significant to the model. And it was built on 22 SPCA terms and 456 genes, where our nested approach actually was built on 9 subterms and 29 genes. And when we look at breaking down how we were actually training the model and testing the model, we found something very interesting. So Tibbershirani's group here, and I think I've run out of pointer, there it is, this yellow curve represents the performance on testing the data. The machine actually knows, or the algorithm actually knows, what it is actually looking for. And then this blue curve here is training. So we cut up the data, we train on half, we test on the other half, and models that are associated with high complexity, especially in high throughput data analysis, have a tendency to have a great deal of distance between the training and the testing curves. And this is referred to as something called statistical shrinkage, or model overfitting. And as you can see here, we are doing about the same, but our curves are right on top of each other. So when we have new candidates come into the office and they ask, you know, Tom, if I decide to join the group, what is it that I will be working with? And I simply say, you're going to help me take this curve right here and pin it up into the upper left-hand corner. And that is exactly what we have done. So this is the part of the talk that I'm going to get extraordinarily animated about, so please forgive me in advance. So I need to set the stage just a little bit about deep learning applications in the biosciences. So this is the genomics field's attempt at artificial intelligence. And so I've got a simple Google image search. We have an apple here on the left and an orange on the right. I'm always amazed that I can punch in apple and get an apple, and punch in orange or type in orange and get an orange. But the underlying statistics, the computational statistics that go into this, are very involved. And the level or the amount of data that is needed to train the algorithm to get you to that point where you pull up an apple and you pull up an orange, it's a great deal. So I like to use this analogy, and I hope this does not come across as gratuitous, but this is my granddaughter right here. And I use this to illustrate the difference between artificial intelligence and human intelligence. Now, our family is bilingual, and the Bulgarian word for grandfather is Diado. And at 18 months, when this picture was taken, it comes out as Dodo, Dodo, which is fantastic. We bought her a miniature soccer ball, and it was her favorite toy at 18 months. She's found her mother's smartphone, so I don't get to go out in the backyard and play with her very often anymore. But she would come over to the house, open the front door, I'd be up in the den, and I heard this, Dodo, Dodo, ball, ball. And that meant that I needed to go out in the backyard and kick it around with her a little bit. Now, right before Christmas, my wife had set down a bowl of oranges. There were about a dozen oranges on the coffee table. I heard the front door open, and I heard this, Dodo, Dodo, ball, ball. And I heard this big commotion. And by the time I had gotten downstairs, a dozen oranges were all over the floor. My wife was trying to gather her and the oranges at the same time. But my wife did something absolutely brilliant that would not have dawned on me. She sat my granddaughter down on her knee. She peeled the orange, and she just shared it with her. And my granddaughter instantly knew that that was something, that was an orange and not a ball. And so those are the differences, or one of the differences with artificial intelligence and human intelligence is the amount of time or data that goes into training the model. And these are things that we are actually working on. Now, I don't have the time to go into the specifics of our first deep artificial neural network model, which we've built three since then, but these are proprietary models that our first attempt was looking at assigning pathogenicity to genetic variants in the human genome. And we've done this for every location, every single nucleotide variant within the human genome, or possibly could. And as you can see, 10 years ago, we were just at about 66%, and now we are greater than 99%. These tools are incredibly fantastic, and I'd love to go into the specifics with it, but I put everybody to sleep, and I'd end up running out of time before I get to what we are doing with breast cancer and lung cancer. So again, I'm going to come back to this slide with the molecular subtypes of breast cancer. And 10 years ago, we were just looking at classifying estrogen receptor positive and estrogen receptor negative. But now we've gone into, with the help of one of our expert geneticists, I think Shannon Bailey is in the audience here today. He said, you know, if you really want to get to the meat at it, why don't you take a shot at classifying luminal A and luminal B, which are further subtypes within the estrogen positive classification or molecular subtype. So here are our ROC curves, and this is just absolutely fantastic. It's mind-blowing to me, and again, it has not been by design. This was a real surprise, so I need to set the stage a little bit here. Our blue curve here represents our estrogen receptor positive and negative comparisons. It is built on two mutated pathways, or 10 genes, and five aberrant expression pathways, or 146 genes, where our luminal A and luminal B comparisons are built on four mutated pathways and eight aberrant expression pathways. Now, these are extraordinarily specific. And the reason I'm telling you, sharing that with you this morning is that the gene intersect between these two models is only six. Of the 400 genes that we are identifying that provide this type of classification performance, there are only six shared genes here. Now, one of the problems with artificial intelligence or machine learning is that these tools do fantastically well on the data set that you're actually training it on. So we wanted to test this to see if we were picking up true biological signaling within the data. And so we looked at a second data set of an additional 129 breast cancer patients, and what we find is that the luminal A and luminal B actually does better. So we train the model here, we find the patterns across these pathways, we fit them with some pretty advanced mathematics, and then we just go back in, we identify the same genes, and we are getting better classification accuracy. Now, I refer to these pathways as feature space. So from a statistical point of view, we are defining feature space that is highly predictive of these two conditions. Now, Pengwei Yang, one of our computational statisticians, came into me when we were working on building this second model or testing this model on the second data set. And so there's a real concern here. We had 30,000 pathogenic variants between estrogen receptor positive and negative, where in the second model, when we identified the same genes, there were only 20,000 variants. And the overlap between the two were only 30, or was only 30. There were only 30 variants between the original 30,000 and the second data set of 20,000. He said, there's just no way that this is going to work. I said, okay, just run the statistics on it. Let's see what happens. And we get the identical patterning. So what it's saying is a defined feature space, we are getting the same exact patterning, even though the variants are occurring. They're occurring in the same genes, but they are occurring in different genomic locations within the genes. It's just absolutely mind-blowing. What we are doing is finding a patterning associated with the mutation burden or load across these pathways or this feature space. And I'm going to tie this together of how this is analogous to facial recognition and how what we have identified as important features of the face. Now, this, and I don't want to belabor the point, but now we've done something that has never been done before. We had the models built on a certain platform, RNA-seq platform. It's built on evaluating discrete count data. We went back to an old microarray data set that these patterns are associated with signal intensity, completely different type of data. We identified the same genes in these original pathways, and as you can see here, we're getting the exact same fit to the model, just not across data sets, but now across pathways. So we are truly uncovering or defining the underlying biological signal. Now, as you can see here with luminal A and luminal B, we fall off a little bit, but six genes were not in the model. We could not identify six genes with the microarray. So this is extraordinarily significant, and Big Pharma is very interested in this because they have warehouses of old microarray data that we can go back now and evaluate. Okay, so I'd like to talk a little bit about lung cancer. It is the leading cancer killer in both men and women in the United States. And as far as five-year survival rates, it is much lower than some of the other leading cancers, such as colon, breast, and prostate cancers. And it's a big issue. This is a Chinese company. WuXi Actech bought WuXi NextCODE back in January of 2015. And this is a real issue, even a bigger issue in China because of all the air pollution. So we are working very hard with this, and we found something that was absolutely even more mind-blowing to me. We are at 100% classification accuracy when we're modeling squamous cell lung cancer versus lung adenocarcinoma. Completely different pathway. And earlier in the talk, I said, we are redefining biology. And our CSO came in and said, Tom, I finally understand what you mean by this, because he was looking at the molecular pathways that we have defined. And he came in and he said, you know, it didn't make sense to me that you've identified a pathway that's associated with ear morphology. What the heck does ear morphology have to do with lung cancer? Well, we're getting 100% classification accuracy, and this represents the misinformation, if you will, that is housed within these genomic ontologies. The ear morphology genes, highly predictive of the two different lung cancer states, but they were probably discovered by a group of developmental biologists that were actually working on lung morphology. So that's what I mean by we are redefining human biology. Now, to show you that this is not actually perfect yet and what we are working on, I had talked about the mountainous amounts of data that you needed to train these algorithms. We actually looked at a very small data set and trying to delineate something that is very specific. So this RAS-RAF oncogene pathway, we were looking within adenocarcinoma between this pathway being mutated and not. And as you can see here, we're getting a little bit of distance. We're down to about 83% accuracy, 83 out of 100 times, but we've got a little bit of statistical shrinkage. And this has to do with the degree or the amount of data that we're actually modeling. So we are working on very advanced probabilistic programming algorithms that we believe when we take a Bayesian statistics approach will actually remove this, and we can start looking at smaller data sets. Okay, so where are we actually going with this? And earlier I had mentioned about this being akin to facial recognition. We have identified aspects on the face or features on the face that are highly predictive. So you can take two images of the same individual, maybe 10 years prior, and you can say with a certain degree of probability that that is actually the same person. This is exactly what we are doing with human disease. And we are feverishly working on developing disease profile recognition algorithms for every known disease. So a patient can come in, sit down with the physician. The physician knows nothing other than their next generation data, their sequence data, and can assign a probability for every known disease. So that's the first model that we're actually, or the models that we're working on. The second approach is this probabilistic program induction of disease concepts. So it's easy, well, not easy. It's a much different problem saying this is the difference between cancer X and cancer Y. But if you start looking at cancer X, we are now generating concepts of that disease so that we can know where it has come from, disease initiation, look at progression, and under different environmental conditions, actually know where that disease is going to evolve to. And so we are taking Bayesian probabilistic learning models, and what we are also doing, which to me is the power of this artificial intelligence tools that we are developing, is that of all the known genes within the human genome, there are about 67,000. We've only assigned functional relevance to about 18,000 of these genes. So these pathways or these signatures that we are identifying, all we do now is fit these genes of unknown function that have the same pattern within these pathways, and we are actually building a giant jigsaw puzzle to these molecular pathways. And that's what I meant, that these tools, as we learn more and more and more about the human genome, the more robust these tools are actually going to be. So before I close things down, I want to thank everybody at BCH and the Harvard Medical School, Chris Walsh, Mike Lodato, and Molly Ringwald, everybody at Research Computing who I was working directly with, Amir Karger and Chris Holton, the University of Oxford, Chris Holmes, which actually gave my start. I don't know if everyone knows Chris, but he is arguably the number one theoretical statistician in the world, and he had given me a great opportunity to come study with him for about 10 years. Everyone at WuXi NextCODE Genomics, everyone here knows Shannon Bailey is here in the office. He's our breast cancer geneticist. And again, I'd like to thank everybody for your time and letting me share with you something that I am extraordinarily passionate about.